Hey everyone, welcome to this week's Azure Infrastructure Update. It's the 17th of February and a couple of nice updates this week. As always, I have the chapters so you can jump to any particular update. And for new videos this week, I got round to part 9, I think, of the Azure Masterclass, Databases and Artificial Intelligence. And then I've been updating my studio PC. I put it in a new case, trying to make it quieter. So I did a little video just about thinking of cooling if you were to create your own machine and just in general, some of the things to consider. So on to what's new on the compute side. So there were some new VM SKUs. So the DLSV5 and the DLDSV5. So the little D variant means it has local temporary storage. That's on the host, so it's non-durable. So these are general purpose, but they do have a, for every one virtual CPU, it's 2 GB of memory. So a bit more compute focused around those, but it's just some new types to give you different characteristics for those ratios of CPU to memory and other types of capability. More general purpose, a web server, a batch server, maybe video encoding would all be good use cases for these new SKUs. The AKS, so the Azure Kubernetes Service, has a new upgrade scheduler in preview. So if we're using those automatic update channels, this could be maybe just around the patch, so it stays on the same minor version, but goes to the latest patch version. It could be stable, where I go to the N-1 minus version, or rapid, just giving the latest things. One might still want to control when that happens. So before we had maintenance controls, but now we have this upgrade scheduler. And what the upgrade scheduler does, if I can actually get the link to open for a change, we can actually see it gives us more granularity. So the top table, this is showing what the maintenance window would do. So yes, we could have some times in the week, particular days, for example, of the week, some hours we could do it, and times we weren't allowed. But if we look at the new AKS managed auto upgrade schedule, we have a lot more characteristics we can control. We can pick specific ranges of dates we cannot run maintenance. Then we can set the duration for the windows, day of the week, interval weeks, interval months. It's more granular. We have more control over what those things may actually do. So that's, I think, going to replace that old maintenance window capability. Static web apps now has Python 3.10 support. So remember, static web apps is all about that pre-generated content. My HTML, my CSS, my images, my JavaScript in those HTML pages could have been created by some other language. But it also has managed functions. So when I do need some server-side processing, it can just through a relative path call one of those managed functions. Well, as part of it, it will actually go and build that function and deploy that function for you. So now if that managed function is Python, it can be 3.10 and it will still go and get it from the repo, deploy it out to Azure Functions and give me that nice relative path I can call from my regular JavaScript, for example. And with that, Azure Functions now has Python 3.10 support in GA, which is kind of required if we're going to call it from an Azure Static Web App. Azure Functions also now has an SDK type binding. So with an Azure function, it's event driven. So we have some trigger, and then we can have additional bindings for input and output. And before, these were always based around some of the more common events and data sources. But with the SDK types, now for other Azure SDKs, we can use those for those triggers, use those for those bindings. Now, initially, it's being restricted just to the .NET isolated types of worker for Azure Functions, and it's only for the blob SDKs today. So for example, with the new SDK, instead of just being sent a blob, I could stream a blob, so I could have much bigger amounts of data being sent to that function. This will grow over time, but this preview capability is introducing the ability to work with other types of Azure SDK as both triggers and bindings for my Azure functions. And durable functions, those stateful, longer running functions, maybe they're doing a fan out and then a fan back in to aggregate the results. Maybe it's a chain of functions. Maybe there's some human interaction maybe it's a viewing and monitoring other things, well, that's now supported with the .NET isolated. So I can use .NET 7 as part of those isolated workers. Remember, isolated means I'm using a version of .NET that's separate from that running on the underlying host itself. Well, now with that .NET isolated, we have the .NET 7 as well. Azure Functions also has availability zone support now in some new regions. Now, the AZ support, I have a choice. Remember, we can do zone redundant. So availability zones have that independent power calling and networking. The idea is there are multiple data centers in each of those availability zones that have independent power calling networking. So if there was some power substation, if there was some network problem, it would only impact one availability zone. So for my workload, I want to think about, well, I want to be deployed over multiple availability zones. Either I ask the service to be zone redundant, and that means it will just distribute as I scale out over all three of the availability zones. Or I can be zonal. If it's zonal, I'm pinning it to a particular zone. I say, hey, AZ1 or AZ2 or AZ3. If I'm doing zonal, it's because I'm probably creating silos or pods of my workload, and I'll have a silo running in AZ1, a silo running in AZ2, and a silo running in AZ3. So Azure Functions lets me leverage that. So it has availability zone support for both zonal and zone redundant. And here you can see the list of regions where I can now take advantage of that. Now, you do need a premium plan to be able to leverage this. So this can't be used for all of the Azure Functions. But if I have that premium, i.e. Elastic Premium, or even dedicated app service plans, then I can take advantage of those availability zone options. And Azure Functions have increased the Linux-based Elastic Premium number of instances I can have. Now, the exact numbers do vary still by region, but for West US, UK South, South Central US, and North Europe, it increased to 100, and for France Central, it increased to 60. And there's a limits page that show you all of those. And then Container Insights now has some customizable settings. So Container Insights, like all of the insights available in Azure, give me this curated set of maybe metrics and logs that it gathers that it thinks are the most important ones for things I want to know about, and then will give me maybe dashboards, workbooks that use that data to give me insight and maybe recommendations on what I should do. And Container Insights, exactly the same. Gives me great information about the nodes, the deployments I've got, the pods. Well, all of that works by getting data by default every minute and sending it to a Log Analytics workspace. Well, I pay for that ingestion. And sometimes, hey, maybe I don't need data at that fidelity. I don't need it every minute. Maybe I want it every 5 minutes. Or now I could say for 1 to 30 minutes at 1 minute increments. So I can control how frequently it goes and gets the data. Well, that will change the amount of data going into Log Analytics, which will change your bill. So if I went from 1 minute to 5 minutes, that's a fifth of the data. So my bill will drop to a fifth of what it was previously. In addition to the interval, I can also say, do you know what? This particular namespace of information, I don't care about that. Maybe it's some aspect around pod information or node information. There are particular namespaces that I can now include or exclude. Now, obviously, if you start excluding namespaces, some of those workbooks that look for that data will not function. Some of the displays and the insights will not function. But it does give you the option and the power to turn the things on and off that you think are important for your organization. So instead of just saying, hey, it's too much data, I'm going to turn this off completely, now you might say, hey, I'll just capture it every 5 minutes instead. On the database side, there was a number of PostgreSQL flexible. Remember, flexible is the go-forward strategy for Postgres. It's not using that single server really anymore. There's no really future growth in that. Flexible is based on VMs. It can use burstable VMs. I can stop and start it. I can have optional high availability. I can tweak hundreds of different configuration settings. Well, now we have Azure AD based authentication has gone GA. I need at least one Postgres administrator that is an Azure AD account. And then that Azure AD based Postgres administrator can then go and add other users and groups to get roles within Postgres. That includes managed identity. So if I have some other resource, it can use its managed identity to be given permissions on Postgres. So no shared secrets or worrying about local accounts. Additionally, custom managed key has gone GA. So my key in my key vault and is used to provide that extra level of encryption on my Postgres database. And it now has a major version upgrade. So previously, Postgres could do minor upgrades in place. If I wanted to change the major version going from 11 to 12 or 11 to 13, I had to create a new instance and migrate the data. So that was a very high impact operation. Now I can do in place. Now it's going to use the PG upgrade utility. It is an offline upgrade. So there will be some downtime associated with that, but it does mean it's very, very simple. It's all, hey, I click, I'm going to do the upgrade, and there we go. Azure SQL, MI and DB had some things go into general availability. So one was optimized locking. Imagine I have some transaction and that transaction is operating on thousands and thousands of rows. In the past, as part of that transaction, it would lock thousands and thousands, maybe hundreds and thousands of rows. And it would be locked for the entire duration it took to update all of those rows. So what optimized locking does is there's a new type of transaction ID and that has a lock for the entire duration. But then it locks the individual rows only as it's updating them. So instead of all of the rows being locked for the entire duration of maybe a very complex transaction, each row will only be locked for a much, much smaller amount of time as that individual row is updated. So if I have concurrent operations and transactions going on, there's a much slimmer chance of actually getting a locking conflict, which causes locking escalations and blocks. So that's really going to help with that. There's also now transparent data encryption has automatic rotation for that CMK. Remember, the CMK is in my key vault. Azure Key Vault has key rotation policies that I can set an interval to say, hey, automatically rotate this key every 18 months. Well, I then, after I've set that up in Key Vault, or I could manually rotate it in Key Vault, but if I check the box now as part of the transparent data encryption to use auto key rollover, when it sees there's a new version of the key, it will just automatically start using it. There's nothing I have to do. So if I did combine this with the Azure Key Vault auto rotation policy as well, I'm completely hands off. Key Vault will rotate the key, transparent data encryption will see the new key and start using it. And a managed instance now has a tempdb max size configuration. So tempdb is the sum of all my tempdb files. I can have multiple files. And in the past, the maximum size was really just based on the particular SKU, the different service level I'm using. For example, general purpose, I think it was 120 gigabytes, something like that. But now I can actually set a max size configuration per tempdb file. Now the recommendation is set them all to be the same maximum size. Because of the round robin algorithm it uses, if I make them different sizes, it could get very different between how it's allocating the space. So I want them all to be the same size, but I could now pick my own maximum size. So I could make it smaller than the service's maximum. I can't exceed the service's maximum, but I could now make it a smaller size if that's something I wanted to do. And then SQL database now has virtualization-based security for always encrypted. So VBS is a feature of Windows Server. It's used for things like Windows Hello, Credential Guard. And in the past, we had this always encrypted idea that we could use hardware-based software guard extension, so SGX part of Intel. But I had to use those special confidential type virtual machines. But if I did it, the benefit is, well, normally you've always encrypted at the client, it does the encryption, it sends the ciphertext to the database, and it really limits the types of operations I can perform because all there is ciphertext. When I used the Always Encrypted with the Software Guard extensions, well, then I could have a special enclave that could decrypt the data, and I could do those rich type sorting operations, rich type comparisons, but it required those confidential VMs. So what this does, instead of requiring special hardware, it's using that Windows Server virtualization-based security to create a software-based secure enclave where it can do the same thing. It will do that decryption, and it will then let me do those server-side rich interactions with the data. Now, I can still use the Intel SGX-based confidential VMs for the absolute top-tier security rooted in hardware, but I don't have to anymore. Now I can instead use that software-based virtualization-based security. And then SQL Serverless for Hyperscale is in preview. So remember, Hyperscale is designed for those very high performance, very high capacity. It separates out the transactions coming into page servers that have the actual data. And then Serverless is designed, well, dynamically scale the resources as I need it. So it's combining those two things. So now my compute and storage will scale automatically based on the demand up to 80 vCores and I think 240 gigabytes of memory per replica, the database storage up to 100 terabytes. It's going to auto scale the primary replica and secondaries individually. So the primary replica may scale differently from the other replicas. And I think it's based on vCore seconds. And this will hopefully show us that, because I can't remember it exactly. But if we go and look down, so that's the general purpose. Then we got Hyperscale in preview. And so we can see here the primary replica pricing. And yeah, so there's vCore seconds. So I pay for the work it's doing, and it shows me what that vCore hour would be. Then there's the high availability replicas, the named replica pricing. And once again, as I mentioned, it's going to scale independently. So that primary replica will scale differently than those high availability, those named replicas. And finally, Cosmos DB for Cassandra, Apache Cassandra database, now has cluster key indexes. And this is really just about application performance. In the past, as data grows, well, the performance would start to degrade. So what the cluster key indexes does is the performance won't linearly degrade anymore. It's going to enable faster queries. It will reduce the amount of request units I use because of that index. And I'm just going to get, even for very large partitions, really good performance now. So that is in preview as well. And that was it. So quite a lot of updates this week. As always, I hope that was useful. And I'll see you on the next video.